3, 4. Every day's the same old story. How they care and how they worry about you. Don't do this, don't do that, but they don't know where you at all. Yeah, every day's the same old song. Seems like everything is wrong about you. They say my hair is too long.
Hi guys, to everyone, I'm Ada from Poison Rock, and today, for my pleasure and as well your pleasure, we have an amazing singer vocalist, Mats Levén. First of all, Mats, how are you? How are you?
I'm fine. I'm in Sweden, Stockholm. Okay, Sunday night, it's dark.
Yeah, like here as well. And yeah. I want to start asking you, of course, the beginning of your career, but not especially your musical career in the band, but like how Mats Levén get in touch with music and singing as well.
Yeah. Well, I started pretty late because, you know, I was a music fan since I was a small kid.
Yeah.
I listened to a lot of music, and but I never really had any friends who played in a band. You know, I lived in a small town outside of Gothenburg on the West Coast.
Okay. Yeah, yeah.
And it wasn't until my best friend started to play drums.
Okay.
When we were like 15, maybe 16, 17 years old.
Teenager, basically.
Yeah, maybe 16. And he started to play in a band, and they needed a singer.
Yeah.
And he asked me, can you sing? And I was like, I don't know. And that's how it started. So I was about 16 at the time, I think.
Yeah.
So and then I joined another band. And I was like 17 when I recorded my first demo tapes or whatever in those days, like,
and what,
you know.
What can you tell about this first recording of your first demo tape? What it was about?
It was actually in Swedish. There were Swedish lyrics, yeah. And I think we recorded them both in Swedish or English or something. It was another guy, actually the bass player from a Swedish band called Alien. He played bass and sang in this band, but then I replaced him as a singer. And that was like 1980, 1981 or something. And then I kind of joined a real band around 83 that was called Capricorn. And they basically played like Deep Purple covers. So they could play really well. And that was like the first time I kind of discovered my voice, kind of.
Your
you know,
skills, yeah.
Because I was so brought up with Deep Purple, so it was a really good start for me to do Deep Purple
like,
covers.
Like a warm-up, to warm up your voice.
Yeah.
I mean, because
so that's, that's how it started.
Basically, because you explored, really, you went through a lot of different genres to sing. And of course, like, at the beginning, you can say the most well-known band that we know at the beginning is Swedish Erotica. With you, you basically released two albums, but with a huge gap of years, one in 1989 and one in 2005. So
yeah, that was like a compilation or like a demo. Yeah.
Yeah. So what? And I mean, because Swedish Erotica were like we can say in the middle of the what is called, I don't want to say glam period, but something like that. You know, like the Sons of Swedish America era, the golden era.
Yeah.
You call it that. So I was, you know, because you were in Sweden, I guess. So coming from from Europe and having this huge wave from the United States, how was back then? I mean, the period of Swedish Erotica, okay, because you basically threw up a motto, which was wild, young and free.
Yeah. Well, the thing is that album was released in 1989.
Yeah.
And but I had played with the guys for like 2 years as a cover band, you know, in small clubs in the Gothenburg area. And we probably started to play together around 87, right when, you know, when Guns N' Roses came and all those bands and stuff. And they asked me already 87, 88, if I wanted to join their real band that was called Swedish Beauty or Swedish Erotica later. And I wasn't really interested because I was a bit more into the classic rock style. So they went to Los Angeles in
Yeah.
1988. They had a demo tape with Göran Edman singing, another great Swedish singer. And they got the contract with Virgin. So in 1989, I just helped them to do backing vocals on the album. You know, so
Yeah, yeah.
they had another singer. But then the producer who wrote Wild, Young and Free and Rock and Roll City, he wanted to replace the singer they had with me. And he asked me why I wasn't in the band. And I told him, you know, I already said no, but I would say yes now if they asked me, you know. So that's what happened. But I, you know, so it was really, I was not really involved in the writing
Okay.
of that album because I was not in the band when they wrote the
The
songs.
song.
So I just came in the end and did the vocals.
But anyway, you put your own influences like in the vocals as well, and then
Sure.
performing of in the video and the lives as well. You have some good memories about that period being in, of course, in the Swedish erotica, and as well, like I was saying, in this golden age for this type of rock, you can say, because I wouldn't say metal or rock in general.
I mean, for me it was great because it was everything was it was kind of new to me to get out in Sweden, and we played in the UK in London and Birmingham as well. And so for me it was like the first time I actually played some kind of bigger stages. And so the whole it was a great time, exciting time for me around 89, 90 when we released the album. The vibe was great as well, even though we probably came a bit late, you know, if you compared our music to like bands like Dokken or Rat or whatever, we were kind of
Quite right.
late, you know. We were like 4 years after them, so our kind of music, what we did, was probably maybe a year or two too late, really.
But you
But
say that remains until today.
yeah, sure. But
Okay.
so you know, so it's and we had some problems with the release of the album as well, because the distribution company went bankrupt just when the album was
No,
coming out, because
unfortunately.
we had a lot of pre-orders on the album. So
Unfortunately.
it could have been a bigger album here in Sweden than it was, but different
Oh.
circumstances led to the
Yeah.
album not succeeding as much.
But as well, after that, I mean, of course, Swedish erotica left like a sign, we can say, in the art rock. I don't know how to call it, a new wave of art rock. I don't know, glam, what I don't know. It kind of left this print. But as well, after you've been the voice of Treat, so as well, there is the change of your vocals going a little bit more like we can say in the Europe band style. So what about those periods in Treat?
Well, the thing was that Treat was probably more the kind of music, or
Yeah.
the way that album sounded, with a bit more like a Hammond keyboard and stuff.
Yeah.
That's kind of what I was brought up with Deep Purple and stuff. So I kind of felt at the time that that was more my style than the Swedish erotica style. That's what I
Yeah.
felt, at least at the time. Still, I was pretty new in the business. I was pretty, you know, I listened to so much music, so I could have played many different kind of genres, but I
Yeah.
really, you know, but I, you know, but I really like the classic one guitar, one keyboard sound. So,
Like the
but the
pop, yeah.
weird thing is that when I joined Treat and when we started writing the album, the whole grunge thing happened,
Yeah,
and both
exactly.
And both me and Anders, the guitar player, we really liked bands like Soundgarden and Temple of the Dog and Alice in Chains and stuff. So we were
Yeah.
like, we didn't really want to call the album Treat anymore. We wanted to start a new band with a new name. But we had to call it Treat because the management wanted it, and
Wanted to.
record company as well. So we were kind of stuck in between what we
Yeah.
did and what we wanted to do. You know, it was a weird time. So,
Yeah.
that album really didn't happen either, because the kind of, you know.
Unfortunately, yeah. Yeah, and then of course after that, like basically in 1995, so after 1 year, the grunge arrived with Leif Edling. You started basically. It started as a kind of a friendship or relationship that then brought you in Candlemass. So I can you explain all this long journey, because of course in the between you had other projects as well that of course we speak in a bit, but the main is so this can say this meeting, this friendship relationship in 1995 brought you into Candlemass, which you've been for a long time. So what about all this journey? You can explain, of course. And then how was back being in Candlemass, that really it's a completely changing of style that we were looking at in Doom. So that shows as well. And I have to say, congrats, you have an amazing voice because that shows your talent skill.
Yeah, well, I mean, when I did the album in 95 with Leif called Abstract Algebra, that is just getting re-released now on CD and vinyl. That was a totally new thing to me. But it was great because that's the first time I kind of dipped my toes into the darker, heavier Doom style of music. And I noticed that I really liked it. I thought it was great. It was a new challenge. And so that was the start of my friendship with Leif. And so we kind of, after that album, three of us in the band plus a couple of other guys, we became friends and did a lot of stuff together. We met up every week and, you know, whatever, went out and had beer or whatever. So the friendship kind of started there. And then we started doing the second album as well a couple of years later. And that never really happened. And then Leif reformed Candlemass. And when he reformed Candlemass, I helped him with all the demos and stuff, just as a friend, because he wanted to give the other guys in the band finished demos. So I helped him playing all the instruments, doing the vocals in my studio. So we kind of kept in touch all the time. So I was kind of working in the background.
At the beginning,
Yeah, doing demos and helping them out with the stuff, you know, just being a friend.
Yeah.
And at the same time, that first album, Abstract Algebra, was super important to me because that's the album that Ingemar Malmsteen heard. So that's why I got the job with Ingemar Malmsteen in 96.
Yeah, yes, that's why I want to go as well, because of course with Ingemar Malmsteen is a completely changing, because of course we all knew his way of playing this guitar, like he said, the neoclassicism and baroque play of style guitar of Malmsteen, that you basically was live, singing live with him in Facing the Animals. And I mean, it's a masterpiece, like an angel, amazing song that that it's perfect. So, and as well, you got to change all this life, all these styles. And I was as well with Mads, because we got from Candlemass, Swedish Erotica, Treat, and then Ingvar Malmsteen.
Yeah, I mean, the Ingvar Malmsteen thing was, you know, it was just great for me because it was my first world tour, and it was like kind of put me on the map, people kind of knowing a bit more about me. And obviously I had a lot of calls after I did the Yngwie thing, a lot of power metal bands and stuff wanted to contact me and stuff, but I wasn't really into power metal at all. I was more like, you know, like Ingemar Malmsteen, he was also a Deep Purple fan. He loved Richard Blackmore, Deep Purple. So we had that in common, even though his music was a bit different from Deep Purple. But we had that in common. And so, you know, so the Ingemar Malmsteen thing was super important to me. And it was the first time I actually co-wrote an album as well, writing lyrics and melodies for the album. So it was good for me as well to kind of recognize that, okay, I can actually write stuff as well. I can come up with good ideas. And that's basically 97. That's when I started making a living out of being a musician for the first time. So that's kind of when I really became freelance for real.
We could say that collaboration with the period with Ingvar Malmsteen was like a, your beginning, like the career, like living, like I'm the singer, this is my job.
Yeah, exactly.
But then, of course, you had tons of projects. I mean, Therion, Duckface. I mean, I just got lost in all the projects you had. But I think the most the people that the one that of course recognize you mainly are Candlemass and Therion nowadays. Yeah. And they are both different in a kind of way. So how do you, I mean, handle all these differences, vocal skills, and as well influences from different guitar way of playing, drums, rhythm, it's all different. So how are you able to handle all of this?
Well, I think with Therion, it was the good thing with Therion was that Christopher, who is the band actually, Christopher, he was really open to try out something new.
Yeah.
Because when I joined the band, that was the first time that he had like a front man, someone being on stage, being like a rock front man. Because I told him that I'm not interested in being in the background in a choir or something. You know, I will do what I always do, and I will put that into Therion and see what happens. And he was really open to that, and I was lucky that he let me do that. So it didn't feel that strange to, I could just be myself, kind of. But at the same time, of course, I had to sing in different languages, in Spanish, in German, and, you know, old Hebrew or whatever. That was great. And that was great.
Which language was the hardest you have to learn?
Well, Hebrew. It was only one song, so that was cool. I thought it was fun. It was fun because it was challenging. It was something new. I always listened to so much different music. So to do something that was that different was just great for me. I thought that was a challenge. And with Therion, I actually got to travel the world even more because Therion are really big in some different parts of the world. So it was a great experience. And then, of course, I was involved in the Gothic Kabbalah album that came in 2007. And so that was a really, really good experience. And I did my maybe 150 shows with Therion. So that was awesome. And, you know, and then comparing that to Candlemass, it's totally different, of course.
Yeah.
But Candlemass, when I did the Candlemass thing, you got to turn the time back a little because I had actually already done three albums with Crux, with Leif Edling. And the Crux albums, they kind of sound like Candlemass, but with keyboards and my voice, compared to Candlemass. So the style, I had already gotten used to Leif's style of writing. The slow doomy songs. So once I started helping Candlemass out, I was kind of already easier. In the mode. Yeah, I was already in the mode of that. But looking back to me in my career, of course the Yngwie album was really important, but also the first Crux album from 2000 was super important because that's when I kind of decided that I wanted to do stuff that was different to like Treat to Swedish Rock or whatever. I wanted to do something that was darker, that, you know, just darker. Meant more. Yeah, felt deeper to me, you know. So I had to thank Leif for that again.
Yeah, and of course, I mean, like we said before, you basically are able, because with all this difference, I mean, genre in your career, it shows that you are able to sing and perform and collaborate with different musicians as well. But in like mass level, like if you not would like to choose, but there is a kind of genre that you feel there is like more yours to sing and perform like, in which you feel more comfortable and more yourself.
It's kind of hard to say because I like so many different styles, but I mean the last few years now.
Yeah.
From 2020 until now, I've been playing a lot and recording a lot with a Swedish band that is called Prins Svart. And Prins Svart, it's in Swedish.
Okay.
But it's kind of like 70s hard rock.
But
you know, it's a bit different. And the cool thing with that, this band, I'm kind of really free to do whatever I want to do.
Mm-hmm.
And we have no limits when it comes to songwriting, to what style, or because everybody is so good at their instruments as well. So I feel very, very comfortable with that band singing what, you know, doing Prins Svart. And we just did the biggest album I ever did. You know, we did like this double album during the pandemic, 77 minutes, and a really cool album. So I feel really comfortable doing that. But I also felt really comfortable doing Candlemass and Crux because that feeling of going up on stage with those bands, you really felt a strong
Thank
feeling
you.
being on stage, and the music was
Really.
really strong, you know. So
Yeah.
I felt really, if I would go back and look at what bands really felt the best on stage, it would probably be Crux, CandleMass,
Yeah.
and Drin Svart that I'm doing right now. Those bands have been really special to do shows with, I would say. And I mean, it's been great with Therion as well, and
Yeah.
it's been great. I'm playing with Vandenberg now as well, and had some really good shows as well. But I mean, but at the same time, you know, if I put on a record at home, I wouldn't listen to that kind of music. I would listen to David Bowie or Peter Gabriel
Yeah,
or
in fact,
Björk.
I was going
Or Björk,
that
you know,
to ask you
so.
about your musical influences, of course, because with all these different type of genre, of course, like you said at the beginning, of course you started may doing, you know, for example, Deep Purple covers. So which are actually like just let's pick at five, for example, of your main influences, musical influences.
Well, it's probably the influences from when I was a kid. That was Black Sabbath and Deep Purple. And then it kind of became Peter Gabriel.
Yeah.
And then in the 80s, I started listening more to David Bowie once I was like 15, 16. But, you know, I listened to a lot of other stuff as well. And you know, one of my favorite bands has probably been Radiohead for many years. You know,
Wow,
Radiohead
that's
is,
amazing.
I'm
Yeah.
a big favorite band. So, I mean,
That's amazing.
I would probably say like Radiohead, Black Sabbath, Deep
It's a
Purple, Peter Gabriel, something like that.
Yes, and I think that's one of the things that really brought you in a, you know, like a, in the music scene, like one of the most you can say talented vocalists, because of course you're not set in one genre,
No.
you're not set in one, so you can really sing basically with anyone and every type of music,
No,
and
not ever.
I mean, from what I heard until now,
Yeah.
I mean, I told you I have this fun since, and I was like a little upset, to be honest. I like a little bit, like how can I say, shy or just excited, because you know, get used to see yourself like you like in the video clips and the lives, and then you have in front of you that the person that you followed for, like I said, 20 years is
Yeah.
a for me the big step, of course, like a big achievement today. And
Yeah.
but of course I'm listening as well that you have so much different influences is important, because it's as well important for people and guys, girls outside that
Sure.
for example are fan of Mass Level and all your work, understand that you can listen any type of music, you can be even a metalhead, a glamster, whatever you want, and listen any type of music
Sure.
and even play it. So that's as well important. And of course, like just about the current project, about so that today, what is Mass 11 doing? What we can expect in future, like in 2023?
Well, I mean, we just recorded the new album with
Okay.
Vandenberg, Adrian Vandenberg, who used to play with
Yeah,
Whitesnake.
yeah, yeah, yeah.
And so we
Yes, he's
just
as
we
well
wrote that.
another huge guitarist as well. So it is a huge, yeah.
Yeah, so we just so that album is getting released this year,
Okay.
and we're doing shows and like a
Yes.
tour after the summer and so on.
Okay, so
And
you're doing it.
right now we are recording the new album with the Prince Svart, my Swedish band as well.
Fantastic.
So that will be released in May.
Okay,
So
and with this last minute, with this band, this British band you have, you feel more like you know, not you do you all like you have more power, but like you can freely express yourself in the lyrics as well.
yeah,
Okay.
sure. Yeah,
Okay.
it's very different from other stuff I've done. But it's very liberating because we release everything ourselves. We're in total control of everything. We don't have a record company. We don't have
It's
anything.
just
We pay for everything, but we put up the money and then we get the money back because we own everything ourselves. So it's a great feeling because it's
there's
like
gonna chance
it's it,
that
and
Europe
we're
gonna see you live, like around Europe.
yeah. I mean, I hope that we can record an album take some of the old songs and record them in English instead, rewrite the lyrics. And so we can actually do shows outside of Sweden as well, at festivals and stuff, because you know it's really hard to it's a hard sell when we sing in Swedish, so
Yeah, but I think, you know, as I think that if the band has good, like the fans loves the band, doesn't matter which language you sing it.
No,
Because right
it
now
could work.
there are a lot of northern band in different genre, folk and metal, that just sings in Finnish, in Norwegian,
Yeah,
Swedish as
I'm.
well. So I think that if you like the band, you learn the language again. It's like English.
But I mean, we sold albums in Holland and Germany and stuff. You know, people contacting us that like the band. So
Yeah, very
yeah,
good.
but
That's
still,
that.
we don't know.
Yeah.
We haven't decided yet. So we'll see.
So,
But it's
so.
but this year is basically Prince Vat and Vandenberg,
Vandenberg.
and maybe if I have the time, it depends on how much I will be on the road. But you know, I'm working on the second Sky Blood album. The first Sky Blood, that's my
Oh,
solo
that's
album.
your solo album, wow.
I did Sky Blood in 2019 on Napalm Records. So I'm working on the second Sky Blood album
And
when I have the time. But I don't have much time right
of
now
course,
because I'm doing some session work as well as a singer for another thing, and you
I
know,
mean
so I'm kind of busy.
yeah, basically, since you started in the beginning of the 80s until today, you didn't st never stopped. You always, I mean, e even
No.
if you weren't, you know, like it was like singing was mainly your job. You were always that
Yeah.
was your future. It was like a call.
Yeah, I mean, you know, I always liked to you know, I like to kind of challenge myself. I like to
Yeah,
do new
challenging.
stuff. But at the same time, I mean, for a while, I also wanted to be able to just sing. I didn't want to take any regular job or anything. I just wanted to give myself a
Your
chance to really
passion.
make a living being a musician, which has been tough
Of course.
sometimes. So, and of course, sometimes I really have to do an album because I need to make some money if I can't go out touring as well. But nowadays, probably the last 15 years, you know, I say no to a lot of things because
Because
I just don't I don't want to do too much. But
yeah,
sometimes,
literally.
you know, I say yes to a couple of things and suddenly there's a lot to do. You know, so
Yeah.
it's different. It's
Yeah, always.
it's all about the experience. But you know, I really the only thing I kind of miss is that I would really like to do something that is totally not hard rock. You know, it would be fun to do something that is really, really
Something
totally,
grunge,
you know,
like.
more, no, but more like, you know, like more the Radiohead thing or like
Okay,
more
okay, okay.
something like, you know,
You
whatever.
mentioned Björk before, like, for
Yeah,
example. You
she's
mentioned
awesome.
Björk.
Yeah, she's awesome.
Something like in that wave, like wave as well, like you could say like more experimental.
Yeah, I don't know.
Who knows?
Because the thing is that I was brought up with from my father, I was brought up with opera. From my mother, I was kind of brought up with more contemporary jazz or
Yeah.
Frank Sinatra or whatever. And then I had one brother who brought me into the hard rock world. And then I had one brother who had all the other stuff. He had like Supertramp and David Bowie
Yeah.
and Sparks and The Wall with Pink Floyd and. So I got all those things to listen to
Those
that I really liked,
influencing.
you know. And I just happened
So it's what
to be a hard rock guy. You know, I happened to be a
so,
hard rock guy.
but mainly these shows where all the diversity and then of genre came from as well from your family give you like
Yeah.
the intimate.
Yeah.
And you mentioned before your solo project. What I add, what I mean, what about this new album, this solo project, and the first album? I mean, what do you like? Because of course, being your solo project, you're free to write your own lyrics. And I mean, what you like to write, for example, in the lyrics, in a topic, like or express yourself.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't really have like a plan when
Okay.
I start writing stuff. I don't have a plan at all. It's just whatever, you know. Normally when I write, kind of the title, you know, some lyrics come up and you pretty soon have like a title, but you still don't know
Yeah,
what it's going to
of
be
course.
about.
Yeah.
And it's very much, you know, you just start singing stuff and it comes from your subconscious.
Yeah.
So without you understanding it yourself, okay, I probably want to sing about this, so I probably should write something about this because it feels, I feel strongly about writing those words. Okay, I should probably write something about it. But there was
writing,
no plan.
Yeah.
There's no real plan behind it, you know. And it's the same with Prince Fat. When we're writing Swedish as well, it's like, you know, the lyrics can take any way depending on, you know. There's no real plan to it. But of course, if you listen to Skyblood, Skyblood is a bit like, when if I'm going to play hard rock and I want to do something my own way in my own style, that's what Skyblood is. Because to me, when I listen to the Skyblood album, it doesn't really sound like anything else to me. And I think the reason for that is that, you know, I don't start with guitar riffs for the songs. It's not that much about the riffing. It's more about the vibe of the songs. And,
because if you
play this kind of music, you normally have a lot of guitar riffs and stuff, which can be great as well. But since I'm not like, I didn't start out as a guitar player, even though I play a lot of the guitars on the album, I played my own way, kind of, you know. So it becomes a bit different. And that's the fun thing with it. And I was just lucky that Napalm wanted to release it right after I split with Candlemass. So I'm, you know, so it's supposed to be fun with music. It's supposed to be fun.
Yeah, of course. So it's always
I try to have fun with it. And I'm not really in a situation when I do my Skyblood thing. Yeah. I don't really need to make any money out of it, you know.
Because it's your own thought, yeah.
I just want to get it out of my system, and I want to do it, and I want to be able to look back on it in 30 years and just be proud and look at it. Oh yeah, that was
like
that
a
was
time
cool.
box. Yeah, yeah. Like time capsule. Yeah.
That's the most important thing to me is that. That's why I can be super picky. Once you start to mix an album, or when an album is, you know, when you're finalizing an album, I can be a total dick, you know, when it comes to complaining about, you know, levels of stuff, because I'm like, I'm always like, man, we got to make this absolutely the best we can, because we can't, for the rest of our lives, we can't change this. This has got to be. And that's the reason I started doing this, is because it's important to me. I really want to do, I want stuff to be good. You know, I just don't want to make some money, just do it and get the fuck out of there. That's
because
not my style.
Stay. No, like just some work, some job, like memories that has to be stay, like you want. And of course, and of course, I mean, before ending the interview, of course, especially like I said, multiple times, you had these incredible careers. Usually say, what is your advice, you know, for just the new metalheads, blah, 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 just in general. What is your advice for the younger people outside that just want to get into the music? And because, of course, the times are different. You saw devolving all those type of different technologies as well. And you witnessed that, especially the distribution in the social, you can say, in the music. So what will be your advice to these, you know, young girls or guys that wants to put themselves out?
Well, I mean, I think the easiest advice is that you really need to do what you really love doing. You can't do the mistake of starting doing things just because you think it's a smarter career move, it's a smarter way of making money or anything. Mm-hmm. If you're going to get into this business that is so tough, you really, really got to love what you do, and you really got to enjoy playing live, and you got to be sure that you get out and play live as well, because you really, and it doesn't matter if you play covers for 5 years, you should do that. I played a lot of cover shows. Which was great for me as well, because I learned so much from the masters, you know. I learned so much from bands that came before me, singers who came before me, that I got inspired from, you know. So it's really important that you love what you do, make sure that you play a lot, and also super important that you start to write music to try to get your emotions out, and also because writing music is important financially. It's important to actually be in control of your music and to write and contribute. And maybe you don't, and even if you can't really play an instrument, at least maybe you can write melodies or you can write lyrics and all that stuff. And it's important to, you know, to get your thing across, you know? So it's just find, you know, you really need to love what you do or really like it.
Exactly.
Because you can't expect that you will survive in this business just because it's a great business to make money of, because it's really tough. It's really tough.
It's tough, yeah. Yeah, I'm witness that. But what can I say? It's really, it's been a pleasure. And finally, did this interview that I tried for really like 10 years to do it. And I want to say thank you, Mats. Really, it's and I hope to see you, I don't know, out there in some lives with Vandenberg or just with by yourself,
sure.
No matter where. Because finally, I can really, because that motto, even if you didn't write a Wild, Young and Free, is tattooed all. Was my motto basically for all my
youth. Okay.
So, awesome. Yeah, that's really shaped my life, like cool. that beginning. And you know, like when I saw you the first time there, and then I saw you with Malmsteen, I saw that okay, and then in Candlemas, I still today I think there are few musicians like singer like you, artists like you that are able to do all of that. So I really wish you that all the best, and that especially to go out with your personal project. Because I think that would be the best thing for you. And I wish you all the best and enjoy this Sunday, this Sunday night. And thank you. Thanks for everything. Yeah. And
thanks. And I've got to put my kids to bed now. So
yeah,
it's time for them to go to bed and go to sleep tomorrow. So I got to put them to bed now. So.
Thank you so much, Matt. And
thank you.
Have a good evening. Bye.
You too. Hope to see you in Italy.
Yeah, okay. I hope so too. Bye.
Sacrifice.